Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Margie Haseltine. Margie, amongst many other things, has been the CEO of Mars Australia, and we're incredibly fortunate to have her as one of our beachheads advisors here in Australia. So, Margie, over to you.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you to all the participants who have are listening in. I hope to make this as entertaining as I can, and not too dry. So I guess the first thing I'd like to say to you is a little bit about my own background and then also what today is going to be about. So my responsibilities were for Mars. I ended up as the CEO of Mars Food for 5 years, and that was the full management of the P&L, the profit and loss statement for a food manufacturing business. We had 580 people. We ran 24/7 shifts. But before I made, I guess, that step, I was the head of the Mars Inc. supply chain, which was over $1 billion portfolio, and that covered food, snack and pet. And I'm going to talk very much today about supply chain rather than logistics, because what I learned through my time there was that there's a lot of value to be unlocked through that whole supply chain. And since I left Mars, which is close to 10 years ago, I've now been a non-executive director and board chair on many different kinds of companies, and some of them are quite diverse, from publicly listed to private companies. And what I've also learned from that increasingly is the importance of supply chain. And when I first started out on boards, people didn't understand supply chain. They weren't the sexy thing to be talked about. But now there's very much a demand, because there's an increasing pressure on companies to be able to unlock value along that supply chain. And a good example of that is, you know, when we look at Coles, they've had 26 quarters of price down, and those costs are being absorbed somewhere, and they have to come out of the supply chain. So let me go back to the beginning and really talk about the outline of today's webinar. We are going to say, what are the links in the chain? We're going to dive into the freighting piece, the shipping piece, the channels that you can export to, very importantly, the financials. We're going to cover off some case studies, and thank you very much for the people that have spoken to me to get those sort of unlock some of those nuggets I can share today. And I guess my other point is that, are you optimizing your supply chain? So the audience today, I know, is twofold, and it's important that both are here. One, the people starting out who are saying, gee, I want to export to Australia, or I want to export full stop, and I'm not quite sure what is a supply chain and how I go about it. And the second bit is a hope for those people who are already in market. We can unlock some little nuances, or you can learn something that actually says, gee, you know what, I could actually improve my supply chain and unlock some value and use that money to be put into other things. So really, I'm suggesting that those in the market, this is a bit of a challenge, this is a bit of a refresh, and you should really sort of think through. And for those starting out, by all means, there may be lots of questions. I've got to go at a reasonably high level, because there's actually, while it might seem two words, supply chain, there's actually a heck of a lot of stuff, material to cover off. So it's going to be very high level. We will have time for questions at the end, but I do encourage you, if there's things you want to pick up more on, that we actually take those on one-on-one sessions, because I won't have time today to dive into pricing and margin, and there's been other webinars with regard to that, and also with regard to marketing. So I will repeat some things, and I'm going to repeat them for a purpose. And the two or three messages that are going to come out is, number one, are you successful in New Zealand? If you're successful in New Zealand, then things bode well. If you're not successful, you've got challenges even in your supply chain, that's something where I say to you, well, it won't get any easier coming across the Tasman. So are you successful in New Zealand? The second is your P&L, your profit and loss statement. Do you understand where the money's going? What is value adding value? Who is adding value and what is not, or who is not? And the ownership of the goods. Where does that transfer? Because that's a very important part about whether it's Australian dollars, New Zealand dollars, who owns your goods, and very important in terms of from an insurance point of view and a branding point of view. And the other thing is, there's going to be quite a lot of terminology. some of that terminology is there for a reason, because if you don't understand what it is, you should. And I know it was sent out, I think last night or this morning, there'll be a bit of a cheat sheet around some of that terminology. So if you're not sure, you can actually have a look and understand it. So rightio, let's get started. So my other point around supply chain and understanding from a P&L point, as I said, is who's clicking the ticket? How many people along the way are clicking the ticket? And you have so many options that require thought and planning before you even start to embark on entry into a new country. But the good news is there's plenty of people to help you. So whatever you do, ask questions. And even people have helped me with the case studies today, said, look, if people are serious, they're more than happy to talk to people, they're more than happy to support people, as is NZTE. And the other thing I'd say is make sure you work backwards from wherever you're going, from the retail or your consumer end price, work out your margins. So what is supply chain? Supply chain is end to end, paddock to plate. What do I mean by that? So I mean that when you're procuring, no matter what you're making, whatever product you're making, you're procuring those goods from somewhere. So it could be that whether it be meat or milk or a metal or a flour, or that is when your supply chain starts. And that's when you start spending money, when you procure those items before you start manufacturing. And I'm just going to give you a little example of my own. But what I'd say to you is supply chain is not trucks and sheds and warehouses. It's all part of it. But what you see in front of you is the whole of supply chain, from when it arrives from your consumer's plate back to where it originated from. So I've got a couple of good examples and a good example and a bad example, just to give you a whole feel. One of my roles in Mars was to source herbs and spices and put them in jars. And then we did a wonderful thing from a marketing point of view to put them in wooden herbs and spice racks. And some of you might still have some of those in your kitchen. Well, we did a fabulous job of sourcing the herbs and spices and we put them in the jars. And then we went and bought the wooden racks from China, and we didn't understand our supply chain. And the person that we thought we were buying the wooden herbs and spice racks from was not the person that we were actually buying them from. So when the $350,000 worth of wooden racks arrived, guess what? The jars would not fit in the herbs and spice rack. And it was a lot of pain, a lot of embarrassment, and cost a lot of money because we had it for a promotion. And promotions are things that are time sensitive, and if you don't have your goods. So there was a lot of expediting, a lot of money, and it wasn't a good experience. However, I learned very clearly the lessons of what was full supply chain. From a positive example, I'd give you that M&Ms, just plain M&Ms, would retail for around $2 a kilo. But when we did personalised M&Ms, which is, Margie and Stephen's wedding or something, and not M&M or M&S on that little tiny M&M, that would retail for around $55 a kilo. So they're good examples of saying, you know, what's at the very, very end of your product, your promotion or whatever it is, and how does that relate all the way back through your supply chain? So even though you may not participate in all stages of the supply chain, it's really important you understand how it works and what's the connection between each step. And an example from Wade at Abe's, it's very clear that a third of your supply chain is around your product, which is getting your product right, whether it be branded or private label. A third around is supply chain, which you see the diagram in front of you says there's lots of steps along the way. There's lots to go right in those steps and there's lots to go wrong. And a third around the real estate, which is the channels, which you see there with the shopping trolley there. It says, you know, those are the channels or the real estate to get your product into the business. And as I've said, there's lots of acronyms. So the earlier you understand every step along the way, the acronyms that are going to be used, the easier it's going to be for you. So I'll repeat, if you're successful in New Zealand, then coming into Australia or any market makes it a lot different. And the other thing I would say there is around, if you look to the channels or the plate, it's very important in my herbs and spice example around DIFOT, which is delivery on full on time, or DIFOTA, which is delivery in full, on time and accurate. So have I actually met my needs? That's really important because a Coles and Woolies would expect minimum of 98.5% DIFOT. And, you know, a Costco or an Aldi is the same. They if you've got a promotion, they need those stocks. The other point I'd make is around this whole thing around sales and operations planning, which again is full supply chain, which says if you haven't procured enough back at the paddock stage, you may then not have enough along these steps to meet the demand, or you might have too much, which is going to tie up a whole heap of your working capital, which is your cash, and it may impact your shelf life, or it could then cost you obsolescence. It's expensive to get rid of products, especially food products. And the other question I would ask you is, why are you exporting? What are you trying to do with that exporting? That's a fundamental question. Do you need volume to fill your manufacturing site if you own your own site? Do you have excess capacity? Are you co-manufacturing? Or do you have a brand that you're trying to launch, which I know we've done a whole session on marketing. You've got a brand, that's a very, very different proposition from launching a brand to putting a private label product in, which has a different supply chain to whether you're going to cafes, food service. So we're going to go into those channels. So it's really important that you understand why you're exporting and what you're going to try to get out of it. We'll just stay on that side. Thanks, Brian. So I'll just, before we move off the slide, you really need to understand when you're moving from New Zealand to Australia, are you going to sell your goods in New Zealand dollars, Australian dollars? Are you going to sell your goods in New Zealand? Is someone going to pick them up and move them across from New Zealand? Where does ownership pass? It's really important that you understand where ownership passes, because that will cost you money if you don't. But it certainly makes it very much easier who's taking control of your invoicing. So one of your biggest challenges when you come to Australia is deciding what to do and when. And I just want to give you a little, another little story, which is not such a great story. But when I started out in, well, no, I've been probably in Mars about 10 years, and we started to export to Russia big time, and we thought that this was going to be the biggest thing. And in fact, it is for Mars now. It'll be well over. It's probably $1.5 or $2 billion of business in Russia. But we started exporting the bottles of marinade and tomato sauce across there, and we were pumping it out. We clearly hadn't got our sales and operations planning right at all. And secondly, we hadn't got our procurement right, because instead of we were palletizing the goods, and we put the bottles on green pallets. Little did I know at the time that by the time the goods moved across the equator with no silicone bags to absorb the moisture on green pallets, that when the goods got there, all the labels were mouldy, and also it was costing us £20,000 a week of demurrage in the UK. I got a fair, let's say, bollocking for that, and had to go and sort out the problem. But we ended up having to strip the labels and co-manufacture and repack, and it's a good news story in the end. But that's a classic of saying, you know, people think they know what they're doing, but when you go to a new market, the whole supply chain is really important in terms of that procurement. We might head to the next slide. So now we're going to dive into the three parts of it deeper. The first is the shipping bit. What's the end game? Then channels, and then financials. So with shipping, I say, what is the end game? Because is the product going to go less than a container load, a full container load? Is it going to go to a third-party logistics provider or a fourth-party logistics provider? Are you going to cross-dock it? Is it ambient? Is it chilled? Or is it frozen? Is it dangerous? Or is it fragile? Do you understand the customs and the tariffs in there? And then when we go to the channels, which real estate, which avenue are you going to sell? Promoting your products, and then the financials. So let's go back to the shipping one, and let's talk about stock ownership. I just gave you the example of the Russian example, and that one, Mars owned the stock all the way through. Just imagine on that one, if we had put it free on board, or we sold it in Australia and we'd shipped those goods to Russia and someone else had taken responsibility. Huge issues about quality of stock, demurrage, where the end consumer was going. It's no different here. So once you've worked out your end consumer, who's responsible for this? So if you send a poor quality good, or if the good is sitting on the wharf, and inevitably, I'm sorry, things usually go wrong rather than right, but when they, even if they do go right, when do you get your money? When are you going to be paid? And who's taking responsibility of that? So at the reference sheet, you'll see CIF, that's cost, insurance and freight. Really important, if you're paying the cost, insurance and freight, it's pretty clear those costs are all yours, and you'll know to put those in your margin. If you're selling them to a distributor and it's free on board, then this distributor obviously has to pick up the cost, the insurance and freight, and you know that you're only paying it to get that to the ship. All of those things impact, and I often hear examples of people saying, well, why am I paying this distributor this huge margin? It's actually not a margin. What it is that you're having to pay for the costs all along the way. Someone's going to have to pay for it. And if you haven't factored those into your goods, you're going to get a surprise. So the terms, cost, insurance, freight, free on board, demurrage, whether it sits at a wharf, whether it sits at a warehouse, is it less than a container load, a full container load? How many cases are going to go on a pallet? How many pallets per container? Is it going to be hand stacked? If your goods arrive at Costco, you need to unwrap your pallets so they're good to go. Is it a broker? Are you an owner? Is it a distributor? Customs clearance? All of those things are really, really important. So my message here is understand it. Make sure you're really clear where you're going, who's responsible, and then work back from wherever your end customer or consumer is. And there's an old saying about, you know, make versus buy. Even if you want to transfer your stock to a consolidator in New Zealand, you should understand all the steps and all the costs so you understand where your money's going. So if you get big enough or you choose to, you can do it yourself. Now we're going to have a look at some channels. The retail channels, we've got the chains, we've the independents and the private labels. So in the chains, we're talking Woolworths, Coles, the Aldis, they all have different terms. And Coles and Woolworths in particular are their 4PLs, fourth party logistics providers. So they will take responsibility if you choose to from New Zealand, or from as soon as it gets into a warehouse, and they will transport all the way through into their warehouses here. Where the independents, which is Metcash, or the buying groups called Metcash, that's IGA, and that's Drake's, Ritchie's, etc. A lot of those are franchised, and the buying group of Metcash buys the goods for you, and they have their own trading terms. Then they will sometimes help you, but more often than not, you've got to still get your goods onto the shelf and pull those goods through from an independent. So they're an independent for a reason. If you have a good relationship with them, actually they're usually easier to deal with and more beneficial than the bigger chains. Having said that, they've been having a few issues themselves with the competition coming in, such as Aldi and Costco. And then clearly, if you're private label, you're not putting a branded product through, you're supplying right back up into retail. With HoReCa, which is hotels, restaurants and cafes, a completely different channel. There are brokers and distributors going into all of those, and they all have their own different trading terms, margins along the way. Same with quick serve restaurants, which is McDonald's, Red Rooster, Subway, Yum. The list goes on. Again, usually you'll be supplying in bulk there, but sometimes you can have a promotion with your own product. And then food service. Food service has almost become, you've got your four big buying groups there, but there are clearly good food service distributors that will take your products through there. So my point around supply chain, rather than talking about the marketing, et cetera, is this is the real estate piece that Wade from Abe's references, and it says, understand your real estate and make sure that you understand what's adding value or not adding value. You might have packaged your product with a heap of air in it and you might be freighting a lot of air. That might be subject to damage. So be really clear about the channel. And I'm not going to spend any time, but margins, trading terms, and pulling those goods through the off shelves, really important. Once you've launched it, that's probably the easy bit. Getting it pulled through and getting consumers to buy your product is really, really important. So in that, I'm just covering off there, third-party logistics providers, distributors, the fourth-party understand it. There are providers as a fourth-party provider, such as EFM, and if your freight spends over $300,000, they will actually do everything for you. Packaging, cubing, is it weighted out, is it cubed? Then just some little terms you should understand, which is, to play in Australia, what's your Australian business number, what's your pricing, point of sale, advertising, consumer promotion. If you're in the big guys, like the retailers, there's cross-docking, vendor-managed inventory, where you, if you're big enough, you'll have your own person sitting in Woolworths and Coles. Primary freight, which is where Woolworths and Coles come and collect, pick up the goods. Electronic data and transfer, advanced shipping note, trade unit number, barcodes. Not trying to confuse you, but you need to get your head around what applies to you and what doesn't. Now let's look at the financials. What's happening here? I'll keep going. I'm not quite sure. The financials. I guess the point I'm making here is that it's easy to lose a lot of money very, very quickly. And a good supply chain will ensure you stay for the pay. It'll ensure you actually have the money to invest. Onto the next slide, I think, Brian, the financials. Yep. It'll ensure you're profitable and sustainable and ultimately grow in Australia. Because you're not here to come in and lose a lot of money, but your supply chain is invaluable, as is your relationship with the distributors or your warehouses. They can make or break you. The other point I'd say is model your P&L before you play. By that I mean get your P&L and do some what-if scenario. Even if you can't do it yourself, get an accountant or someone to help you. So what's your cost of doing business? What are the margins? And most importantly, what's your EBIT? Be earnings before interest and tax and your net profit after tax. It's really important. Benchmark your products. So if you've got a competitor or you can see someone else, try and do that make versus buy. Try and work out what your competitors are or someone who's got a like product and say, gee, if I'm spending 10% more on my supply chain, what's going on there? Or if my distributor is costing me a lot more, what's going on? So benchmarking is really important. And there's lots of templates and modeling you can have. And I've said it before, but how many people are clipping the ticket and how many should be? Because I've met with companies before and they've got too many parties along the way that are taking money and not adding value. So starting out the launch, staying for the pay and growing and enduring. And then come back to why you're exporting. Make be really clear. So are you optimizing your supply chain? This is probably really for the next slide. Thanks, Brian. This is probably really for people who have been in the market a bit longer, or if you're in New Zealand and you're saying, am I optimising my supply chain here? Always have the end game in mind. Always look at your existing supply chain in New Zealand first and say, hey, am I leveraging that? Make sure you understand the cost of your big customers' needs, not wants. They will ask you for everything. They will ask you for promotional items, stock, lots of other things. But you make sure that you're in control. Make sure your packaging and product's quality so it delivers. It's really important that the goods get there in very, very good condition. Stakeholder engagement and management. Once you've got your distributors, your warehouses, even your fourth party, if you're going direct with Coles and Woolies, what are the KPIs? Are they giving you what you're paying for? Often you pay and then you're one of 200 or one of 50, you're the bright thing to begin with, and then it slips away. So make sure you're having those quarterly meetings and the six-month reviews, and saying if they're not delivering the sales from the supply, you know, right across the supply chain, then something's wrong, and you shouldn't be paying them without some kind of performance management. So P&Ls are important. Risk mitigation, stuff will go wrong. So if you're doing a launch, have you got backup stock? Have you made sure that the product's safe from, you know, fumigation, et cetera? Stock turnover and shelf, dye fodder, and making sure you haven't got out of stocks are very important. Don't delegate your responsibility, whatever you do. A branded product is your brand, and it's always your brand. And also the importance of forecasting. Christmas is well and truly already had by a lot of the retailers now. They've already got their planograms. They know exactly what they're doing. Easter, already in plan for. Mars would already be planning their Easter stock and already buying their cocoa, their sugar, and working through exactly what their stock levels are and their promotion and packaging. And cash is king. At the end of the day, you need cash to make sure you sustain. We're having a few technical issues, with our slides. We're all back. I'm running. We haven't quite moved on. So now I'm just going to quickly run through a couple of case studies, and then I can open it up to questions. Have we got lots of questions coming in?
Let people know that the presentation will be available afterwards.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Yep, absolutely. But feel free to fire any questions you got through.
Yeah. I've been going quite quickly, so if there's any points people want me to go back and expand, as I said, I've gone quite high level, but I think it's really important that we come back and reflect on that. So I had a great conversation with Wade from Abe's Bagels, and I'm going to give you Wade's top six in a moment, and it's probably Wade who should be giving you his top six. But one thing to know about Abe's Bagels is they're very successful, which is fabulous. And Wade did say that if someone directly wanted to speak to him, if he was serious about exporting, he's happy to take questions. Their supply chain is, I wouldn't say simple, but they're really in control. So they have their own brand, and they have an ambient channel, which is the crisps on shelf, and they also have a freeze-thaw model. So they're going in two different paths. They own their stock all the way through to the very, very end. So they're invoicing their customer at the last moment. So they own that process, where for a lot of companies starting out, you would sell to a distributor or a consolidator. It'd be pretty hard for you to do that. It's not impossible. That's just one of the end menu items. So Abe's are in control of their product all the way. They own their branding. They do all their own invoicing. They're responsible for all of their own stock. So they're not passing that stock. And that's a really important part. So they have the full P&L model, and they understand what their costs are. So Wade's top six. Significant presence in New Zealand first. So I've said it before, but make sure that you really understand your business and really working that hard. Getting started. Don't assume it's going to be easy. You need Australian business number, you need a bank account, you need a customs account, and you have to negotiate everything. Everybody will try and take the top dollar. You need to negotiate. The unique selling position of your products. So as I said, Abe's are ambient crisp and freeze thaw. That's their USP, and they've obviously got a point of difference in the market. Very hard to compete against competition. Abe's, said the third. A third is your product. Get your product right, your packaging right, everything about that. A third supply chain, talking a lot about supply chain, but it can gobble up your money very fast. And the real estate, who are you selling through, and the channel you choose. Five, complexity of the beast. And that by that, Coles and Woolies, it talks about the compartmentalization of it. I can't even say the word. But what that's saying is you might be dealing with the replenishment manager in Coles or Woolies, but they will undoubtedly not be talking to the supply chain manager, or they will not be talking to the buyer, or they will not be talking to the fourth party provider. So one contact in Woolies is not enough, or Coles. You need to understand all of those and own your relationships with them. And then full commercials. Understand that they'll take a distribution allowance or demurrage allowance, that it is a relationship business and you need to know your business and where the costs are going and margins to make money. So ABES is really, you know, they've spent a lot of time in there, they have a lot of resource in, well, they don't have a lot of resource, but they certainly have customer service manager, they have an accountant involved in this, replenishment people, they're in the market, they really understand what they need to do to make sure they're pulling their product through and a significant presence. The next one I spoke to was Florence at Chia, and thanks for that, Florence. And Florence is top five. Now they have different pathway, completely different, and this is probably more like what as people starting out might be, that where they're actually selling the goods, often free on board, so selling them in New Zealand to the distributor, someone's taking them all the way into different markets, into different states, and then distributing from there. So Florence's top five was know your customer. Where are your products going? And do not rely on distributors. While distributors are fundamental to get your goods and you have to rely on them, and by the way, you have to trust them, do not rely on them because they're your products and you need to own them. Because as I said before, your products might be one of many in a distributor, and no one else is going to be as passionate as you are. So knowing your customer and don't rely on distributors, make sure you have that relationship. Florence's second was get over to Australia every 3 months to improve your, and why? To improve your sales. And to develop a relationship with your stakeholders, your customers, your consumers, and your distributor. And if, for example, if something went wrong with your distributor, they merged, they closed down, you have a relationship problem. If you don't know where your products are going, who they're going to, and how well your product's being received in the marketplace, you're not going to be able to manage it if something goes wrong. You own those relationships, and it's really important that you work those relationships. Again, who's clicking the ticket? Work back from your end consumer or customer and understand every move of the way. The third, PR promotion, or making sure you understand those promotions, because a lot of people, end users or retail or Metcash, they won't take your products on unless you've got a PR program to promote your products to get them off the shelf. That's usually at the time when you're putting your products first on the shelf. So not only do you have to freight your goods, set up your distributors, work how you're going to get your goods into those customers, you need to make sure from a promotional point of view how you're going to pull them through. So factor that into your margin. I think this other one, which was really interesting because I forget because I've been in Australia for so long, is treat Australia as seven different countries. Don't say, right, I'm exporting to Australia and I've done my job. Queensland, for example, is extremely different to New South Wales and Victoria and Adelaide and Perth. And those markets will have different distributors. And if you've got an ambient product, that's one thing. But is your ambient product okay in New Zealand, but not okay in a 30 degree plus environment? Should your ambient product actually be a chilled product in Australia? And then again, will you have problems with your packaging? So you really need to understand where your product's going. And as Florence said, treat every state as different and distinct markets. And you might get a national distributor, but that may not be the best way to start out. So again, where are you going, which channels, and what's your costs along the way? Then I spoke to Tui, and a lot of you may have already met Tui. Tui's with Millennium, and Millennium, I believe, have done two trips to New Zealand on the roadshow. And Tui had her piece of advice was, firstly, know your competitor. So, you know, you might be competing, you are competing, your bench competitor, know your competitor. Make sure you understand when the goods change hands again, when does ownership pass. And it's really important, is that Australian dollars or New Zealand dollars, that makes clearly makes a big difference. Getting your product right, getting your APN or your Australian product number right, getting your labelling specs right, and understand, do those specs comply, and understand the price. One of the big ones that Tui pulled out was is the goods GST applicable? So it might be GST non-applicable in New Zealand, but it could be applicable in Australia. The rules are different. Australia is not New Zealand, and Tui's seen many people get caught out by not understanding when the GST, Australian-New Zealand dollar, stock ownership passing, and as I've said, insurance and freight and stock. So it's really different. GST in particular is really different from New Zealand and can again impact your pricing. And by pricing, it then says that if you're competing in Australia against someone who is not GST, for whatever reason, maybe they've done something slightly different in their product and you are GST applicable, that's going to make a big difference for your price on shelf. So you've got to stand in front of those shelves and stare at them and work back from them to understand all of the pieces. Tui also pointed out the distributors need a margin, and so does the customer. So you really need to understand what your retail price is and the distributor price. Why do distributors need a margin? Well, one, they've got to survive, but usually in my experience is distributors actually work off extremely low margin that goes to their bottom line, which is around about 5%. The rest of a distributor's margin, when people see this, is actually their costs. So if their cost insurance freight, for example, they're paying for those goods to get on the ship, insure them and bring them across. And then in particular, in Australia, food service in particular, but even while in retail, a lot of products are called what's called FIS or free into store, which means that the distributor or you have to pay to get your goods into store. Now, if you're moving your goods from Brisbane to Townsville, Longreach, Northern Territory, and they're free into store, that's a very, very long distance and it's going to cost some money. And I come back to understanding whether your product, how it needs to transport, because there's a big difference in cost between rail and truck and between ambient and chilled. So the normal distributor fees will be around 30%. And the other expectation that Tui said that it usually takes 2 to 3 months for your goods to get on shelf. So there's a time lag there. And you'll need to allow at least a 13-week window, and you'll usually need a PR or, you know, a promotional plan at the same time. And from a distributor's point of view, they'll say, you need to trust us. And I'll put the other side of it is if you're trusting your distributor, they better be doing the right thing by you. So between the two of you, you need to work out what's a harmonious relationship and what works for each. And that always doesn't work. And you need to be careful not to micromanage a distributor, but if they're not doing what you want them to do, you need to be sure that you're paying for what they need to be doing. I come back and reiterate, Tui reiterated the currency again, New Zealand and Australian dollars, LCL versus FCL versus FOB. And then there's another example, which is a company called Nectars of New Zealand, which they actually buy in New Zealand dollars in Auckland, consolidate your product for you if you're small enough, and they deliver, they've got people in every state in Australia, and they will actually ensure you don't have too much stock and will help you distribute. So those are the three case studies, and there's a lot in those case studies, and I know that everyone is really up for talking to you and helping you, as is the NZTE, to do one-on-ones. I'm going to open up for question time. I'm trying to keep to time. I've covered a huge amount of material today, and I really want to make sure that if there are questions, please ask them. But I think it's really important from my point of view, having spent years and years in supply chain, to not be overwhelmed by the complexity of it. And some of us are actually quite passionate about supply chain, see the fun in it. But to make sure that you really think it through so that your product is very successful and gets onto shelves and it stays there and is sustainable. And we've got huge amount of very successful brands in the Australian marketplace where people are getting it right. And I'll also say, like, my examples around palettes and herbs and spice racks, and I've probably got a few more I could share that I won't over my years. I think it's really important that you make mistakes, and that's where you learn from and how you recover from them. And that's a really, really important part. So in summary for me, it's coming back to, you know, make sure you know what you're doing in New Zealand. Be really clear, you know, what your end game is and the price of your end game to survive, and work back and say, where do the margins have to be taken? What are my costs and how much can I afford? Because there's no point in doing this if you're going to lose money. There's no point in doing this if you're actually stealing from your success in New Zealand. And there's no point in doing this if you really don't have the resource and energy and passion to stay for the pay. And for those companies that have been very successful, once you get these teething problems sorted out, it's actually very straightforward. Once you've got those relationships. So supply chain needn't be complex or overwhelming. You just need to understand it. So I'm going to wrap there for some questions. I'm about on time.
Bang on time. That's fantastic. So feel free to fire through any questions. One that I've got straight off the bat is that tipping point between having a consolidator in New Zealand versus a distributor here. Have you got any sort of thoughts about, you know, as companies progress and grow and become more successful, any sort of tipping point there?
Well, I think from a tipping point of view, one would be testing your marketplace. I mean, when you start out launching products, you're really in a trial mode. And so I would have said, even if it takes you longer and costs you more, if the safe way is to go through a New Zealand consolidator, I would stay there and actually spend your energy and resource pulling your product through and working through how successful it's going to be in Australia. Because if you have a unique point of difference, or you know that you've got a good margin, and I've said it before when I've talked to groups before, actually New Zealand does have a distinct advantage over Australia because you genuinely have lower costs, lower input costs, lower labour costs. There's a whole lot of reasons why you can make good money exporting to Australia. So I would use that point to actually say, when do I get to a point where I've got enough for my own, even a half container to consolidate, or to work with somebody to share containers. But if you're just sending less than a pallet load, no, you're better to be consolidating. But the minute you're starting to get some substantial volume, and I would have said, you know, on a regular basis, you're shipping every month and getting up to sort of around a half to a container load, you really should be thinking about what you're doing yourself. But again, I'll come back to testing your product in the marketplace here in Australia and saying, have I got a sustainable product? And you're better to lose money the other end by paying a bit more through a New Zealand consolidator.
And so that, I suppose, is the next point around distribution by state. You got any sort of comments? I mean, you did say that each one of them is essentially a different country. Any sort of nuances there that you can share? Or, I mean, obviously the distance in Queensland is immense. Anything else that springs to mind?
Well, I think the markets are very, very different, and it depends on where you're going into. So if you are into the retailers, obviously you're going to go national pretty quickly. So you need an ability to go national, because if you go with a Woolies or Coles in particular, or a Metcalf, they're right across Australia. So you need to be able to do that. So you'd be saying, shall I go for a 4PL through a Coles collect or a Woolies collect and making my life easy? Or should I go to a national distributor? I gave you the example, if you're actually going to be spending over $300,000 in freight, you could go to EFM, for example, and they would do everything for you. But if you're smaller than that, you might be saying, okay, I could find a national distributor, but maybe I'm better to go state by state because those relationships will be more intimate. So again, I'd be looking at my product and saying, if it's beverages, you're going to have differences in climate. So you'll have a hotter climate in Queensland, clearly, so you'll be probably better to sell, better sales there. So it really depends on where you're going and whether you want a national distributor or a state distributor. I'm hearing that state distributors are probably the more preferable, especially if you're managing your volume. Because if you go national first, then you've got a national volume to deal with and you run your risk of not pulling your product through properly, not launching in a market properly. So my gut feel would be you'd probably better to launch in a New South Wales.
I know that you put a lot of thought into today. There's a lot of material there, a lot of things for people to think about, and look forward to continuing to work with you on your role as Beachheads.
Thank you, and thank you very much. And I just want to reiterate for people listening in today, if those people that you're already in market, if there's one thing that I've touched on today that you say, I want to explore that further, I think it's a good opportunity to challenge yourself. So just think through from a lean point of view, as it is lean, and are you unlocking all your value? And for those starting out, don't get overwhelmed. But I think it's really important. And we are here as Beachheads advisors. I think I've been around for a few years now. We're here to help. So thank you, Stephen. And yeah, it was fun to pull together the. I must admit, I had to. You took me back a little bit to actually go back into working through the supply chain, but there is value to be unlocked. So have fun. But thank you very much.
Okay, thank you once again. And thanks everybody out there for joining us.